Good morning. Thank you for being here. I don't think everyone made it at this early hour, looking at the amount of people in the room. But I think we'll start anyway and see whether more people will come in or not. This session is on sandbox solutions. I'm going to talk about the what, the why, the when, and the how of sandbox solutions. There's a little bit of code at the end, but it's only a little bit, and everyone will be able to follow that bit. A little bit about me. I'm Miriam van Olst. I'm a Microsoft Certified Master in SharePoint 2007 and a SharePoint Server MVP. I work as a SharePoint architect for the Information Worker Solution Department at McCall in the Netherlands. And I'm a co-organizer for the Dutch Information Worker User Group and the Software Development Network in the Netherlands. And if you want to contact me, you can find my contact details at the bottom there. So the agenda is very simple. It's basically what, why, when, and how. So we'll start with the what. Sandbox solutions. Sandbox solution basically is a SharePoint solution, just as we've known them in SharePoint 2007. So it's a WSP file. Looks exactly the same as the old solutions. And it looks exactly the same as farm solutions, which is basically the old solutions that we had in 2007 and 2010. A sandbox solution is uploaded to and deployed from the solutions gallery at the site collection level. And a sandbox solution is completely isolated to the site collection, so it cannot access anything outside of the site collection it's deployed to. A sandbox solution is deployed to the database, so if you write a feature and you put that in a sandbox solution, you're deploying that solution. It won't be deployed to the features folder in the SharePoint root or the 14 hive, whichever name you prefer. It will be deployed to the database. On runtime, when the solution executes, it will copy to a cached folder on the file system, but it won't be deployed to the file system. So SharePoint will take care of that. You can't modify them on the file system. And because of that, a sandbox solution won't be able to bring down your entire farm. It will, at most, be able to prevent some functionality within that single site collection from running properly. A sandbox solution doesn't run within the W3WP process. It has its own process, which is the sandbox worker process. The name is up there. And on that process, there's a code access security policy. So the only permissions that a sandbox solution has are the SharePoint permission for the object model, so you can use part of the object model. You can execute code, and you have minimal ASP.NET hosting permissions. You can use a subset of Microsoft.SharePoint when you build a sandbox solution, so you can't use all of that object model. And that's basically because parts of the object model are outside, go outside of the boundaries of the site collection, and you can't do that within the sandbox solution. So as I said before, it's deployed to a site collection, but it can be managed and monitored within central administration. So this is the subset of the object model that you can use in a sandbox solution. You can use Microsoft.SharePoint except for the SP site constructor, which is logical, right? Because you would create a new site collection, and that's not something that you can do within the boundaries of the single site collection your solution is deployed to. You can't use SP security because you would use that to elevate the privileges of your solution, and that's not allowed because that would run under full control. Well, there's a couple of other things you can't do. You can use Microsoft.SharePoint.Navigation. You can use Microsoft.SharePoint.Utilities. You can't send email from a sandbox solution. You can build workflows and web art pages. So you can do quite a lot from a sandbox solution. This is basically how it works. At the top, you see my DLL and a couple of other DLLs in the gray boxes. And the blue one is the SharePoint DLL, so that's Microsoft.SharePoint. When you execute the code, it will go through the WSS usercode.config, and basically the SharePoint DLL will run in full trust, so that will go to the bottom pink box. But it will only use a subset of the object model, so you can't use the complete object model. Your own DLL will be checked against in usercode.config. In there, the code access security policy is stored, so it will check whether you don't do anything that you're not allowed to do, and then will run within the sandbox process. So that won't have full control. That DLLs won't run with full control. This is the solution gallery. So this is where you deploy a sandbox solution to. It's located in the underscore catalogs solution folder. So that's, you know, like you had used to have the master page gallery. You still have that one, and the site collection gallery. You now also have a solutions gallery. And you can upload, activate, deactivate, and delete solutions there. And this is just the screen. We'll see that in real life as well in a minute. So the monitoring can be done at two levels. A farm administrator will set absolute limits within central administration and can monitor what happens within the different site collections from central administration. A site administrator can, within his own site collection, identify expensive solutions by looking at the solution gallery and basically the bars that are in there to indicate how much resources are used by a solution. A farm administrator assigns resource points to a site collection. Like in 2007, you could already assign a certain amount of hard disk space that a site collection could use. You can now also assign a certain number of resource points that sandbox solutions within a certain site collection are allowed to use. The points, resource points are based on 14 metrics, 14 different metrics, and all of them are normalized to the resources per point property. So they're all resourced or normalized back to resource points, but all in a different way. And I have a table on that in a minute. And the metrics were chosen based on the impact they have on the server. So this is where you set the resource quota. The top screen is basically central administration. You can assign a certain number of resource points that a site collection is allowed to use. And you can send an email when a value lower than that is reached. So to warn the site collection administrator and maybe your farm administrator that certain site collection is using a lot of resources. And the bottom one is the solution gallery. And you can see there the current usage of resources today and the current usage over the last 14 days, the average usage. So basically, if the average usage was like a little bit of the amount you're allowed to use, you deployed a new solution yesterday, and today your current usage is going all the way up there, you know that you have to talk to the developer that built the solution that you were deploying yesterday to ask him to rebuild, because that solution is obviously then using a lot of resources. So this is the table and the way it's normalized. So for instance, you have CPU execution time. You can use 3600 seconds, and that will cost you one resource point. The default is 300, by the way. You can use 300 resource points within a single site collection. If you terminate a process abnormally, one termination will cost you 1 point. So you can see there that the more resources you're consuming, the faster the points will count up. So critical exception counts, 10 exceptions will cost you 1 point. A database query, 20 queries will cost you 1 point. Well, you can read the rest on there. It's basically just for reference. So why would you build a sandbox solution? In 2007, developers would build custom solutions, and administrators would only be able to secure those solutions with CAS policies that had to be built by the developers themselves, usually. And that's kind of hard to control what exactly is being done within a custom solution, within custom code. So the biggest cause of SharePoint support cases was custom code. And basically, people ringing Microsoft up saying, my environment is very slow and it doesn't work the way it should. And then Microsoft would come and check, and the problem would appear to be that someone built a solution, deployed that over the entire farm, that basically was rubbish and used way too many resources, didn't dispose of objects, stuff like that. So within 2010, we still want developers to build custom solutions, but now we want site collection owners to be able to deploy and activate the customizations within the site collection, within their own site collection. And administrators can use resource monitors to check how many resources a single site collection is using. So why would you want that? The business will usually want total agility. They want a simple deployment model. They're going to think of something they would like, some piece of functionality they would like in their environment today, and they basically would like it to be ready yesterday. You know, that's always the way it goes. So they're going to call up a developer, and the developer is going to build it, and he's going to tell them they will have to wait a week until it's ready. So after that week, the code needs to be deployed, so the business will, with that solution, go to the site, the farm administrator to get their solution deployed. And the administrator will say, well, that's fine, but I want to review this code. So it will take me a week to do the review. So that's another week for the business. They will have to wait. They don't want that. And then the minute you deploy it, you know that they're going to say, well, this is nice, but I actually want something different. And the whole process will start again. So the business doesn't want a developer to have full access to the farm, because that will bring down their farm. They want their farm to be stable. They also want to be able to do everything within the solutions that are built for them. So they want to have all resources available to them, and they want a very iterative deployment process. So an administrator will want a completely stable and secure farm. So they want a clean room data center. They don't want anything going on in there. They want an extensive change control process. They don't want anything deployed to their farm that wasn't checked extensively, where they weren't sure that the farm, it wouldn't bring down the farm. So they want to do a formal code review, or let someone else do a formal code review. And they want severe restrictions on resource access. Because, you know, if a developer can't use more than a certain amount of memory or a certain amount of CPU time, then it won't be able to bring down the farm. So the sandbox solution basically makes them meet halfway. There's business agility. You can deploy solutions easily. You can deploy them iteratively, because a site collection administrator, which is usually someone from within the business, can do it themselves. There's also the essential stability for the farm, because there's only a limited API access that you can do, and you can only use a limited amount of resources, and the solution can be monitored. So this is the sandbox that you can use and where it will be safe. So sandbox solutions can help enterprises. They can solve the hosting issues in corporate environments. They can make it easier for people to deploy custom solutions. I mean, I've worked in for customers where deploying a simple solution would take up to 3 months, because you would have to send it over to the US. It would have to be reviewed there. They would send it back, have a question on your documentation. You would adjust that. It would start all the way back at the beginning of the process again. Basically, some stuff would just never be deployed. So it makes hosted environments much easier to manage for the hoster as well, because the hoster can just let people deploy custom solutions without worrying about the solutions bringing down their farm. Using sandbox solutions will reduce the time you need to deploy the solutions, and it will improve the stability of your SharePoint farm. So when would you use a sandbox solution, and when would you use a farm solution? You would always use a sandbox solution, providing you're trying to do one of the things in this list. So you can build list definitions, list instances. You can use an onet.xml to build a site definition. You can use the web template feature, which is a new feature in 2010. This is also being used if you save a site as a template. That will now be a sandbox solution. It will be saved as a WSP file, no more STP files. And that solution will use the web template feature itself. You can use or build content types and fields, so site columns within a sandbox solution, modify the navigation, you can build modules, features. You can build web parts as long as they are derived from that class that's on the slide, event receivers, custom actions, and workflows. Now, there are times when you don't want to use a sandbox solution, because you can't do this. You can't build custom action groups in a sandbox solution. You can't use the hide custom action element in a sandbox solution. You can't build web application and farm scope features, obviously, because that's beyond the scope of the site collection. You can't build timer jobs, because they run within the whole farm as well. And you can't build official web parts, because they need full control to be able to run the user control. Now, there's a couple of other things you can't do, but there's a lot you can do as well. So if you build a solution, I would advise to always start with a sandbox solution and basically try and get that working. Now, if you don't, if you can't get it working and you need to do something that really can't be done within the sandbox solution, you can always easily switch over to a farm solution. That's basically just a checkbox in Visual Studio. And you can change your solution to be a farm solution. Also, if you build a sandbox solution and you, the functionality within that solution can be built in a sandbox solution, you deploy that to a site collection. And the solution is so successful that all your other site collection administrators want to use the same solution, which would basically mean you'd need to deploy it like 20 times. You could always decide to deploy your sandbox solution to central administration as a farm solution. So that doesn't matter. You can deploy your sandbox solution to the farm as well and make it available within the entire farm. So how would you build solutions for the sandbox? What would you do? So if you build a solution, you would first install them into the solution gallery. And when you install them, the solution is validated. You can build your own validation for that. So you can build your own validation rules. If you have stuff that you want a solution to definitely implement or definitely not implement, you can build checks by yourself that will always be run when a solution is installed. You can activate the features within the solution. You can deactivate them again if you want to, and you can delete a solution from the solution gallery as well. And when you delete it, it will be deleted from the database as well. So it's actually a bit cleaner than a normal solution, because if you delete a normal solution, it will leave behind all sorts of files in on your file system, where a sandbox solution will actually clean up after itself. So this is the process. You have a WSP file, webparts.wsp in this case, that will be uploaded into the solution gallery. That's one. Then the two is, it will be, if you activate it, deployed to the WebPart gallery, if there's a WebPart in there. Then a user will request a page with that WebPart on there. That's the three. As soon as it does that, the assembly cache will check if the WebPart's already... the code for that is already stored in the cache on the file system of the server. If not, it will go to the solution gallery, get the stuff they need, put it on the file system for running, and then execute the code within the sandbox code service and display the results on the page for the end user. So I'll do a demo. I'll build a sandbox solution, or a couple of them, and switch to my machine. So this is my portal. It's still empty, except for a couple of enters in here. But nothing has been done to this portal page. And here's my central administration. This is my page. I can go into application management within central administration and go to, under site collections, configure quotas and logs. In here, you can see the amount of resource points that you can assign. It's set to 300, which is still the default, and it will send an email with a warning in there at 100 points. Now, when I was doing a sandbox presentation within our company, which is basically all developers, the first thing everyone said was, okay, so we just set this one to 30,000 and we're fine. Well, you're not actually, because that would make it possible for the sandbox solution within that site collection to bring down your farm again, which is the whole point of the sandbox solution, that it can't be able to do that. So the next thing people came up with was, so but if we have a solution that uses a lot of memory, we can just tweak like the metrics that will normalize the different metrics to the resource points and up that number. Well, you can, but there's people that thought about those metrics and that normalization long and hard. So if you're going to do that, you need to think about it long and hard as well and be sure that what you're doing is actually a smart thing, and you're not just messing with the system and building a farm solution within a sandbox. Because if you would do that, you would make it possible for everyone to deploy a sandbox solution, no matter how crappy, and bring down your farm with that, because you tweaked the results in a way that you shouldn't. And as an administrator, you can control this, because this is central administration. Most developers won't have access to central administration on a production environment. So you should just make sure that you keep it safe and stable and not, you know, go with developers and just give them everything they want. So if I go to the portal again, go into site actions and site settings, you can see here under galleries, I have my solutions gallery. And it's still empty now. No resources are being used, and the average usage is zero as well. So I fired up Visual Studio here, and I can create a new project. I will just create an empty SharePoint project and call it Sandbox. Okay. I can now choose here whether I want to deploy this as a Sandbox solution or a farm solution. So I will go with a Sandbox solution. We'll create my empty solution. There's nothing in here. There's an empty features folder, an empty package, and basically a key. So I'm adding a file to this, a new item. And as you can see in here, I just told you that you can't build visual web parts in a sandbox. Well, you can't. But unfortunately, the UI of Visual Studio doesn't know that. So you can select visual web part in here, and you can modify it. But as soon as you're going to build or deploy it, it will say you can't use this within your sandbox solution. So I'm going to build a normal web part. Just leave the title as it is. So I added the web part. And there's just, this will be deployed as a feature within the sandbox solution. You have your elements.xml. Here's the group. I will change that to something that I can actually find. So my sandbox, the web part will be deployed to that group. This is where I can add the web part as an end user to the page. You can see there's a .webpart file, which has the name in it, which will be shit right now. And there's a .cs file. No user control, because I can't deploy that within my sandbox. I will add some stuff to this. Label, new label. Add some text. Go away. And I will add the control. Sorry. Don't use the snippet anymore. To the page. So I can deploy this now. And it will deploy it to the solution gallery of the site collection I just selected. In here, you can see that its sandbox solution is true. So I could easily just switch this to false, and that would make it a farm solution. It's that easy to switch between the two. You can also switch back again, assuming you didn't do anything that's not allowed in a farm solution. Even if you did do something that's not allowed in a sandbox solution, you could switch back. You just couldn't deploy it again. So I will deploy this. Our deploy succeeded, so I'm going back to the solution gallery, and I should now see the solution in here. Here it is. It's the sandbox. The status already activated. That was in my deployment steps. So I can deactivate it here if I want to. I'm not going to do that now. I'm going to go back to the home page and add the web part to the page. Edit the page. Insert a web part to the page. You can see here my sandbox, my web part, add that to the page. And basically on here you can see go away as cloud. So that's my web part deployed. So it's very simple to build and deploy a sandbox web part. Now this is on my dev environment, of course, and you know stuff always works on your own environment. So you can always just package this up, get the WSP file and upload that into any other site collection on any environment. So that's very easy to deploy as well. Saving this page now. If I go back to Visual Studio, now we just saw on the slides that I can't use SP security. It's not showing up in here. So there's no IntelliSense for SP security. But if I go in here and change this to farm solution, yep. So I have now a farm solution and not a sandbox solution anymore. And you should be able to see that I can select SP security now. So run with elevated privileges. Now, sorry, I shouldn't be able to do this within the sandbox. But if you check, if I go into the sandbox again or change my solution back to a sandbox solution. Yep. I could still use SP security. It doesn't help me with it because, there's no IntelliSense on it, but you see if I type it, it will recognize it and it will know what it is. So it will help you, but there's no way to really shield it. If I would try to deploy this, it would of course fail because it's not allowed. It would stop me from deploying this within a sandbox. But if you have a farm solution and you turn it back to a sandbox solution, you could run into this problem. Now, there's a way around it. There's a limited object model set that's in a DLL that you could actually get and use. So you could reference that, and you wouldn't be able to use anything outside of that. But you would have to change that if you go and deploy. You don't want to deploy referencing to the sandbox solution DLL, to the limited object model set. So now this all worked fine. As I just told, I could save this site as a template, and that would be a sandbox solution as well. So I'm going into the site settings and going to try and find save site as template, which is here. Give it a name, my sandbox template. I'm not going to include content, doesn't really matter whether I do that or not. So this looks exactly the same as it did in SharePoint 2007, but it doesn't work in the same way, because this is actually exporting it. It's exporting the onet.xml, it's creating features for all the features that were in here. It's creating a lot of features, because it's creating features for everything that might be activated in here. So it's not just creating the features for stuff that's actually being used within the site collection, it's also creating the features that you can use within the site collection. So this is being generated. It's being generated as a WSP file. So it's a normal solution package, as you would have if you would build a site definition within Visual Studio. This succeeded. Going back to the solution gallery, and you should now see this site in here. So you can see here sandbox template, which is activated as well. So if I would create a new site from here, you should see my sandbox template as well in here. And here it is. So I can create a new site based on this template. Test site Evo. Creating the new site. So it's this easy. And you could also just save this basically to your machine. Get the WSP file and deploy that on another solution. Now, you'd have to be kind of careful, because within this site, there's my sandbox web part. So if I would put this WSP on another server, but not deploy the sandbox web part that's in there, it would fail, because that wouldn't be deployed with it automatically. That wouldn't be in the WSP file for the site definition. So you can see I have created a new site that looks exactly like the old site. And I could have done this in any other environment, basically. Now, what I also can do is import this solution into Visual Studio and make changes to it. So I can go into the site settings, into the solution gallery, save this to my desktop, go into Visual Studio, and save this for a second. I could create a new project here. And what I could do is import solution package. So creating this new project, saving the old one, as a sandbox solution again. So where is the solution that you want to import? Sorry, it's on my desktop. Importing that. So this takes a little while because it's actually extracting everything from the WSP file. And the funny thing is, a WSP file basically is just a zip file with some XML added to it. If I would rename the WSP file that I just exported it and to zip, and I would look what's in there, it's really, really neat. There's only a little bit of stuff in there. It would look really good. But as soon as I import it, you can see that there's a whole list of stuff that's in there. And I can select what I don't want from here, but I have to be careful with that, because if I select too much, it will break the web part or the site definition. So I'm just going to import everything. So 212 elements. But still, it's quite nice, because if I would have a business analyst or a business user create a site definition or a site just by clicking it together with using the UI, I could export that, import it into Visual Studio, and have a developer make little modifications to it as they need. So, you know, maybe add another feature or change a feature around, add more fields or another content type. So it can be really, really useful. It's just a bit of a shame that there's so much junk in there that's being imported. I'm assuming there's going to be people that are going to build solutions that will extract only the stuff that you need from these packages. Yep. So we're done. Import succeeded. As you can see, there's web templates, the sandbox web template. Here's your own net.xml that basically, you know, contains the features and the web parts that you're using. Nothing too interesting in there. There's an elements.xml. And here there's the web template feature. So this is new in 2010, and basically this was built for making it possible to save sites as WSPs. So there's all sorts of properties in here. You can see that it saves the base template name and the ID. So in this case, it's the STS template, the normal team site template, and the base configuration, which is zero in this case. So there's other stuff in there. If you would build your own site definition and you would want to deploy that as a sandbox solution, you would use this as well. You probably wouldn't set all the properties, but you can use this yourself. So this is quite cool. You can see here property bags. This is a elements file. Other imported files, so a couple of files used for all items display, edit forms, new forms. Now here you can see a whole list of stuff. Different modules that are displayed with different files in there. Master pages, every one of them. Images for master pages. Approval stuff. And list instances. So these are all the list instances that I could possibly instantiate on the original site definition. It's not just the list that were actually there. And content types, built-in list instances, and features with different levels in there. So this is basically what you get when you export a site definition. I could now just say build, deploy it again, and it would upload it again into the solution gallery, overriding the original one. I'm not going to do that now.
This is essentially unghosting all the files that you normally... So if you deployed this and used it again, are all those files now in the database rather than on the file system?
Yeah, they are, yeah. Yeah, even if you would build your own solution like this, and you would build it as a sandbox solution, you would use a nonet.xml that normally would be stored in the site definitions folder. That will be stored in the database because it's a sandbox solution and it won't be deployed to the file system. So it's not really the same thing as ghosting and unghosting.
Yeah, you can deploy it as a farm solution as well.
Yeah, if you deploy it as a farm solution, it will be deployed to the normal onet.xml location. It just won't use... If you have a normal site definition within a farm solution, you would usually create a web temp file. And this will not create a web temp file and not deploy that to the XML folder, but it will create a feature with a web template element in there. So that's the only difference. But it will basically work in the same way. Just for this to work, within the web template feature, you will always need to say what the base template is and what the base configuration is. So you can't really build your own thing completely, because you would always have to sort of inherit from a standard SharePoint site template or site definition.
Is it the limit of the amount of sandboxes that I may use before it kills my SQL server?
No. At least I don't think so. You can upload as many as you want. You just have the resource points that you can use to think about. So if you upload too many, you will reach the limit that you can use. It's in 24 hours, by the way. So you need to use you can use that many resource points within 24 hours. So if you have a lot of sandbox solutions within a single site collection, you might use all those points up. And if the limit is reached for the points, it will shut down all sandbox solutions within that site collection. So not just the sandbox solution that might be the evil one. It will shut all of them down. But the good thing is, if that happens, it's only that single site collection that's affected. And basically, you can tell the site collection administrator to remove the evil solution, wait for the next day, and everything will be back to normal. I'm going to open up my last project again, because I'm going to try and let the sandbox crash. So this was my sandbox project. And I will put this bit of code in here that will iterate through all lists within the web, within the site collection, and display them. Now, it can only do this for so long, because I will use too many resources and it will shut itself down. Deploying this one. Yep. Go back to the gallery, see if it's there. Yep, new one, just deployed, so this is good. Going back to my home page. I can now show all lists. Ooh, so there was my error already. So doing this, it will iterate for a little while, see that this web part's doing something evil. This is using way too many resources, and it's doing it in a loop. So it's timed. It will keep iterating those lists until it crashes. And the sandbox will shut it down. We'll say, this isn't a good thing. And if I would do this a couple of times, I would be able to actually see the amount of resources I'm using in here go up. I'd probably have to go there more than once. But that way, you can see that it's actually really limiting the amount of resources you can use, and it will prevent your server from being thrown out. So I can iterate all the webs, not dispose of anything. In the end, I will use a lot of memory, but I can only use so much memory before it will shut my sandbox down, tell this site collection to get itself sorted out, and basically keep the farm up and running as it was before.
Is it possible to see what kind of point is consuming?
No.
So I don't know if it's because of the SQL,
No, you won't. Maybe the farm administrator can. I must say, I'm not completely sure, because he has more detailed reporting features to see what's going on within the site collections. But the site collection administrator will only see there's points being used.
When you reach 300 points, you may be able to see if it's 300 times the same kind of error.
Yeah, he may be. I must say, I'm not completely sure. I do think that the reporting for the farm administrator is definitely more detailed. So I'm guessing he will probably see why, what happened, yeah. So, go back in here. Go to my summary. So a sandbox solution is being deployed to the site collection solution gallery. The resources it uses can be used from within the site collection, but also from within central administration. You can use only a subset of the functionality that's available, and that means a subset of the object model, and also a subject, basically, of the SharePoint artifact that would be available within a farm solution. So you can't use, for instance, like the Microsoft.Office.Server object model, because that obviously goes outside of the boundaries of the site collection. It's quick and easy to deploy. It's very, very simple. And it will basically guarantee server stability, or at least this won't bring down your server, assuming you manage the rest of your server correctly. It will guarantee the stability. So that's it. Thank you for attending. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask them now. Yeah, sure.
Obviously,
A visual web art, sorry, is so the question is, what's a visual web art? A visual web art is a web art that uses a user control to display the contents. So you can actually use the designer of the user control of the .ascx file to build your web art, which is very nice for developers because you don't have to write out the label. You can just add the label to your page and put text in there. Yeah, sure. It will still show the site. It just won't show any of the sandbox solutions.
So it just cuts those bits out.
Yeah. Yeah, the first time it will show an error, but I think after that it will just display white. Any other questions? Thank you then. Have a good day.